Every living being within this material world has a strong desire to enjoy matter to its fullest satisfaction. For this purpose, the conditioned soul must accept one body after another. Thus, his strongly fixed, intuitive desires continue. One cannot stop the repetition of birth and death without being completely desireless. Therefore, Srila Rupa Goswami describes pure bhakti devotional service as follows. Anyabhilakshita shunyam kyanam karmadi anavritam anukungen krishnam shilanam bhaktirutamas. One should render transcendental loving service to the Supreme Lord Krishna fairly and without desire for material profit or gain through intuitive activities or philosophical speculation. That is called pure devotional service. Unless one is completely free of all material desires, which are caused by the dense darkness of ignorance, one cannot fully engage in the devotional service of the Lord. Therefore, we should always offer our prayers to Lord Nishrinade, who killed Hiranyakashipu, the personification of material desire. Hiranya means gold, and Kashipu means a soft cushion or bed. Materialistic persons always desire to make the body comfortable, and for this they require huge amounts of gold. Thus, Hiranyakashipu was the perfect representative of materialistic life. He was therefore the cause of great disturbance to the topmost devotee, Prahlad Maharaj, until Lord Dhanashikade killed him. Any devotee aspiring to be free of material desire should offer his respectful prayers to Narasimhade, as Prahlad Maharaj did in this verse. Om Namo Bhagavate Narasimhaya Namaste Jaste Jase Avir Avir Vapa Vatranaka Vatranakusta Krama Svayam Ranthaya Randaya Tapo Krasa Krasa Om Shvaha Havaya Mahavaya Matmani Bhuvishta Pusham. I offer my respectful obeisance from a verse, a Vedic verse in Katha Upanishad, which is Prabhupada quoted many times. The purport of this verse is that even though one may have taken shelter of bona fide spiritual master, one may be in the proper position on the path, still there is danger. Therefore, Uttishta Jagrata, Uttishta, get up, don't lie down, don't become complacent. Jagrata means wake up, stay awake. Don't doze, don't sleep. So, because now you've attained the presence of Guru, one has approached spiritual master. So that position, that status is very good. One is very, very fortunate, so one should not throw it away. The most precious thing that we have been able to approach the lotus feet of the spiritual master. But that does not mean that there is no danger. It does not mean that, oh, now I am initiated. So everything is all right. Let me, as when driving a car, shift into neutral and coast. I don't have to give any more power for myself. Now, Guru Maharaj, my spiritual master, he'll do everything. But that is not spiritual life. We don't find, as Prabhupada said, a very interesting remark he made concerning Arjuna's talk with Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. We don't find that the conclusion, Prabhupada said, is that Krishna told Arjuna, all right, Arjuna, I'll do everything. I'll fight, and you sit down and smoke marijuana. This is not the meaning of accepting spiritual master. No. What is the message of Bhagavad Gita? That Lord Krishna was demanding Arjuna, you act. You engage yourself. You take risk. And it is very, very risky. Churasya dhara nishita duratyaya. Upanishadic verse goes on to say, Churasya dhara, this path, is like the edge of a razor. Not like the flat part of a razor. You know, this razor you take when the King Gopal comes around. So he has this old-fashioned razor. So on the side it is very flat. That you might think, that is the path. Very flat and straight. No. The actual path is the edge. The sharp edge. Rasya, Hara, Ishito is very sharp. Durandiga, very, very difficult to get across this path. Durgam is hard. It's like you want to walk on the edge of a razor. It is how hard it is. You put your foot there. It will be cut. So, Durgam, Patastha, Kobiyo, the Kavis, the wise sages, they have given this warning to us. Do not become complacent, do not become relaxed. To take up Krishna consciousness, Srila Prabhupada said, it means to declare war against Maya. And who are we to declare war against Maya? Tiny, insignificant, jiva atma. 1/10,000th of tip of the hair in size. What is our position? We are fallen souls. We are overwhelmed by the waves of material nature, and yet we are declaring, daring to declare war. Now I will fight you, Maya. Prabhupada says, this is what Krishna consciousness means. So we are so weak, what chance do we have? But as it is said, Kastu says, there is one who is there to protect us. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhagavan Sri Narasimhadev. This form of Lord Narasimhadev is compared. I'm just like, this form is lion's form. So what he said is like the mother lion, lioness. She is very, very fierce. Actually, in the lion community, of lions, one sees that the lioness is actually more active. The lion, the male lions, they're known to be quite lazy. But the lioness, she has to take care not only for herself, but also for her cubs. So therefore she's out on the hunt all the time. The male lion, he goes out once in a while, catches something, fills his belly, and retires somewhere to take rest. But lioness, she has not only her own belly, but cubs are there. And they're very ravenous, very little lions, very hungry, always crying, Mama, Mama, I want something new. So lions are very active, running out, catching antelope, catching deer, dragging it back. So, why is she doing this? Because she is the protector, she is the well-wisher, the benefactor of her tiny little cubs, who are completely dependent upon her. So to the cubs, she's very gentle. When she comes back, she's licking them and feeding them, and they're suckling her. So she's giving full protection. Any danger comes, any threat, like in the jungle there, creatures that will want to attack and eat the little lions. But Mother Lioness is there with full power to protect them. So similarly, the devotees of the Lord, they're compared to the cubs, the little children of the Supreme Lord, Bhagavan Sri Narasimhadev. So just as Lioness is protecting the cubs from all dangers, caring for them, so similarly, Lord Narasimhadev is most, this is his eagerness, this is his enthusiasm to protect the devotees of the Lord. And so, it is the responsibility, it is the duty of the devotees to come under that protection. So we are always in this Krishna consciousness movement, taking risks. This is how it becomes deserving of that protection. prophet said, just to become devotee means to declare war against material energy, but it doesn't stop there. Actually, we are ordered to go out and preach. We come to this movement. Many of us have come to this movement running full speed away from material association, having burnt our fingers in sinful activity, in impure, this impure material world. And so having, as they say, smelt the rose and felt the thorn, having understood that this material existence is full of suffering, although there is some tantalizing scent of happiness there, it is actually a place of suffering. So you come to this Krishna consciousness movement seeking shelter. And then we are told, now you must go back out. Go back out there and preach Krishna consciousness. That is the way one actually overcomes this asat sangha, this material association, by taking this risk for Krishna. But full protection is there for one who takes this risk. We can recall some years ago, 1990, 6 years ago. So myself and Bhakti Bhai Baba Maharaj, we're in a very strange region of the world preaching. This region is called Transylvania. It is a mountainous area of the present-day country of Romania. So Transylvania, you may know, has a reputation. It is the home of one Count Dracula. And apart from that, this Dracula personality actually did exist, and he was a very fierce individual. But apart from that, it is a place of gypsies and black magic and wolves, mountain wolves, and all kinds of dangers are there. So after the communist regime in that country collapsed, devotees could go there. So myself and Bhakti Bhai Baba Swami went there to begin preaching. At that time there were no devotees to welcome us. Completely uncharted territory. So we were driving at night because we got delayed. We didn't want to drive at night, but we were forced to drive at night to the capital city of Transylvania, called Sibiu. And we were just a few kilometers outside. And the road, we'd come out of the mountains, so the road was very straight and flat, seemingly very safe. So Maharaj was driving, I was sitting in passenger seat. And suddenly he remarked, "Oh, something very strange is happening here." I said, "What is that?" He said, "The wheels of this van do not seem to be touching the road anymore." And I was looking, "What?" He said, "Yeah, just see, he was turning the steering wheel, but the van was not turning. It was just moving as if on air, straight ahead." So this was very, very bizarre, to say the least. So he was testing, turning this way, turning that way, and was not affecting the direction of the van. And then all in line, but then he thought, he became a little frustrated, a little alarmed. So he was just turning the wheel fully to one side, as far as it would turn, to one side. And still, the van was going straight, a little bit drifting now to the other side. A little bit drifting. So what is this? The wheels are not driving the car. The wheels are not directing the car. Then suddenly, all at once,